Okay, we're now just at 105 and a half, and so let me formally get our proceedings under the way. So for those of you who just have joined in the last couple of minutes, my name's Peter Lukaszewicz. I'm the CEO of Gowling WLG Canada, and on behalf of the firm, I want to thank you for joining us today on International Day of Pink. Let me say to you, we are, as we were saying to the panel before we started, we're just absolutely blown away, but not surprised when you see the prominence of our panelists by the response we've received to this webinar. We have over 900 registrants. It's an astronomical figure for a webinar. So thank you all of you for joining. The goal of International Day of Pink is to create a more diverse and inclusive world. And our aim in holding this webinar is to contribute to that goal. Over the next 90 minutes, you're going to hear insights from an accomplished group of LGBTQ plus individuals and allies from our firm, from our good clients, the Toronto Dominion Bank and CPPIB, and from the Canadian film world. Together, our panelists will offer their perspectives on the challenges faced and the progress made by LGBTQ plus people in the workplace and in broader society. Our panelists are going to tell us how they've contributed to the fight against bullying and discrimination. They'll share with us how they're working towards achieving equality and acceptance for all. And as they do so, I hope that we will learn how we can be part of these efforts and be inspired to join them in this important work to create inclusive workplaces. Now, as you know, we are an international law firm with offices around the world. And as such, our webinar panels are usually populated with leaders of the business community, like Al and Katie. So you'll understand when I say we are particularly jazzed, pardon the pun, to be joined by Ashley and Chase, who are the co-directors of the new and acclaimed documentary, No Ordinary Man. We'll hear from Ashley and Chase on how their film explores the life of Billy Tipton, a popular jazz musician of the 50s, 60s, and 70s. Tipton's identity as a transgender man was not revealed to anyone, including his family, until after his death in 1989. If you haven't seen the film, the registration confirmation that you got from us includes in it a link to the Inside Out Film Festival. And if you go to that link, you will get complimentary access to stream the film until a week Sunday, the 25th of April. And if you haven't seen it, I urge you to do that. Finally, it gives me enormous pride to announce that today's webinar is the first event to be hosted by OpenHouse Canada, our firm's recently established LGBTQ plus affinity network. Open House is a safe space for our people of all gender identities and sexual orientations to come together as a welcoming and supportive community. Its mandate includes raising awareness and understanding of LGBTQ plus issues, increasing the recruitment, retention, and visibility of LGBTQ plus colleagues, and creating network and career development opportunities. We will be working with Open House to promote the principles of equity, diversity, and inclusion, and to attack stereotypes and stigma across our firm and in the communities in which we work. Our Open House chair, Warren Cass, who is a senior corporate law associate practicing in our Toronto office, is on our panel. And a little later on in our discussion, we'll be joined by a number of other Open House members. We've got a lot to discuss. So let me just once again thank you for being here today in support of International Day of Pink. Let's continue to work together towards equality and acceptance for the LGBTQ plus community in our workplaces in Canada and around the world. Thank you. And now let me turn it over to our moderator, Usman Sheikh. Usman?
Okay. Thanks a lot, Peter. My name is Usman Sheikh. I'm a partner at Gowling's. I'm in our Toronto office. I head up our securities litigation group. I also head up our blockchain and smart contract group. And to get your CPD credits, there's going to be a skills test on blockchain at the end of this webinar. I'm just joking, there is not. I'm totally thrilled, and I have to say totally honored to be joined here today by this amazing, fantastic group. And I am stunned, just like Peter said, probably not surprised though, by the number of people who have signed up to hear this webinar and attend. It's likely because of the Katie Daniels, the Al Ramseys, the other Open House members that we have, but equally our co-directors, Ashling and Chase, who produced this amazingly wonderful film on the life of Billy Tipton, which has frankly been such an eye-opener. So we're really honored to have you and all of you panelists here today. Perhaps just before jumping into the Q&A session with our panelists, just a few words on what Gowling's has been up to on the LGBTQI plus front. As Peter has mentioned, we recently launched and created Open House, which is really an affinity group for LGBTQI plus employees and professionals. And as Peter mentioned as well, Warren, one of our colleagues, a senior associate in our Toronto office, leads that group. We also have a national partnership with the Canadian Center for Gender and Sexual Diversity to provide free legal support for trans and non-binary individuals seeking to change the gender markers on their official IDs. We've also in the past hosted the center's gala at our firm when there was such a thing that could happen. And we have many other initiatives that are planned. So that being said, we're always striving to do more. We're always striving to learn more. And really this session here today is in furtherance of that effort. So with that, I wanted to introduce our panelists. And I think what we decided to do is that I'm going to introduce everyone because I want to make sure we have enough time for the Q&As. And so I'll just introduce people in the order that I see them. So we have Katie Daniels. She is Managing Director and Head of Compliance at CPPIB, or the Canada Pension Plan Investment Board. We also have Al Ramsey, who really requires no introduction because it seems like the world knows him. He is AVP, or Associate Vice President, for Customer Strategy and Sales Development, Wealth and Business Banking at TD Bank. And then we have Ashling Chin Yi and also Chase Joyt, who are the co-directors for No Ordinary Man. And then we have several internal panelists as well. We have David Pearson. He's the head of D&I for Gowling's in our UK office. We also have Rebecca Bromwich, who is the head of D&I, or D&I manager, for Gowling's Canada. And we have Warren Cass, who is a senior associate in our Toronto office. And as we had mentioned, the head of Open House. So I have a bunch of questions. I should say to those in the audience that if you do have questions, feel free to include them within the chat. And what we do is we have a number of people who are monitoring the questions, and we're going to try to get to that towards the end of the session. But if I can sort of selfishly take the privilege of the first question and just ask about the International Day of Pink. Really, this day is an international anti-bullying event that is held every April. And it started really with two high school students that saw another student who is wearing pink being bullied at their high school in Nova Scotia. And those two individuals, as a show of support, decided to get everyone at the school really to wear pink as an effort to support that individual. So maybe my first question is, what does this day mean to you? What does International Day of Pink mean to you? And maybe, Al, if I could start off with you.
Thank you, Usman. And first of all, congratulations on the kickstart, I guess, of Open House. That's awesome. And I'm so excited and privileged to be here in one of your first meetings, I guess. So cheekily, of course, you get to wear pink. It's fabulous. That's why.
Multiple layers of pink.
Layers, exactly. And on Wednesdays, we wear pink. That's another joke I can pass. But really, truly, it means a lot to me, both personally and professionally. Well, I would say personally, you know, at TD Bank, I head up our LGBTQ2+ customer segment strategy in addition to our Black customer strategy. So to me, it is a very important day for us to signal to the organization and to our employees that this is a part of our culture. And this is something that we use. We leverage important moments throughout the year to amplify and to send that strong message to our employees that it is a diverse and inclusive culture. So it's important for us to do that. Leadership matters. So that's why we should do that. I would say leadership matters, visibility matters, which is also important. And as one of my mentors said, visibility is also liberty. It liberates you to say who you are to the world. So there's no shame in that. Personally, you may know my story if you follow me on Facebook or on Instagram or any social media platform, by the way. As a closeted young man growing up in Jamaica, think about that environment. I wish I had an international day of pink to celebrate, to look and see people that look like me, leaders, role models, to say that it gets better or gives me hope. What I saw in reverse were our community, we were shunned, we were deemed as deplorable, and in some case killed. I saw that and witnessed that firsthand in a society. So that's why, to me, it is very important to have these days like this, important markers, to signal to the world that we are proud of who we are. And also, Toronto and Canada is a very inclusive, you know, country. However, we have work to do. Early days in my career on Bay Street, before I joined TD Bank, I was bullied in the workplace. And the question is not about me being bullied as a young intern, was it gave or emboldened that individual to actually do that in that environment. The environment was a very hostile or very toxic environment. So that's why it's important. And what saved me also was because I knew of an LGBT leader, role model, who I knew that was a safe refuge for me, that I could have gone to and had a conversation, and it changed my life. My career was suffering, I changed jobs. And I would say finally, because of the work I do and as a public person in this space, I would tell you the notes and emails and messages I get worldwide of individuals reaching out to me and said, thank you for being visible. Thank you for giving me hope. Thank you for being who you are, because that's all I want to do in my hostile environment is to feel valued and to feel a sense of belonging. So it's a very important day. Visibility matters, leadership matters, but it cannot start and stop there. We have more work to do.
Terrific. David?
Thank you, and congrats, Open House, to my siblings over in Canada. Greetings from the UK, sunny UK here. My pronouns are he and him, and I'm a white cis male. I'm bisexual. My motto, by the way, is love is the answer. And I kind of have a personal mission, which is to unlock the leadership power of LGBT plus people. To me, International Day of Pink means two key things. It's being aware of the impact of internalized homophobia, and it's being aware of the power of allies. You know, my personal story is that I'm aware I have many privileges, but those visible things mask something deeper for me that had a huge impact on my life. You know, where I grew up and when I grew up, for example, wearing pink was dangerous. You know, it's not something I could have done. I would have been homophobically bullied for wearing pink. And so I avoided it like the plague. It was a dangerous thing for me to do. And I was bullied at school and at work. And these things can help to contribute to create internalized homophobia, which isn't something I became aware of until much later in life. I didn't even know what that was. I had no idea what internalized homophobia was. I had a massive case of it. And it took an amazing lesbian counselor to work with me and make me understand what it was and unlock that. So I think the issue that I've found in my personal experience is we tend to replicate in our environments later in life the things that we experience personally when we are younger. And that's why, you know, experiences at school can have such a profound impact on us. You know, when I first came out firstly as gay and later as bi, I actually then started to experience a form of bullying within the LGBT community. You know, for example, people intrusively questioning me, are you sure you're bi? Aren't you actually gay? Are you confused? And, you know, if you think about it, I'm not very good at maths, but I did some sums on the back of an envelope, and I worked out, I think that on average, most people spend up to about 17,500 hours of their life in some form of schooling. And that's one of the most important training grounds where we learn to be an adult and what it feels like and looks like to be in workplaces when we go and join them later in life. So that's why for me, there's this massive role for allies on this International Day of Pink. Allies are in the majority in most workplaces. And human nature is just that we tend to pay more attention to and respect the opinions of people who are similar to us. So when we have someone who is a heterosexual stand up against bullying, if you're a heterosexual person, you probably pay more attention to that. And so allies can kind of weaponize that heteronormative privilege. So before I kind of end, I just want to address one elephant in the room on this day in this session, which is that question you might be thinking, you know, what gives a straight person the right to advocate for LGBT plus people? What gives someone who isn't LGBT plus the right to speak out on behalf of our community? Well, I, as a member of the LGBT plus community, want to make a clear statement that I welcome allies in. I welcome their support on this day. I welcome them wearing pink to support this community and show that they don't tolerate bullying, homophobia, biphobia, or transphobia. So if you are an ally in this session now, you can take it from me, a personal invitation that you are invited in, your support is appreciated, and we want you here. And I'll close by illustrating that when I was at work some years back, about 10 years ago, I was with a colleague who's a straight cisgendered male. He overheard some discussion and some talk in our office that he called out as being inappropriate. He said, hey guys, that's homophobic. We don't speak like that. Now, I was the member of the LGBT community and I didn't speak up, but he did. And for me, that reinforces that massive power of an ally to be there to support this community. So welcome you all and thank you.
Good. So you all have the David Pearson VIP ticket to support. That's terrific. So one thing that David, you had mentioned was just about the experience of International Day of Pinks really started at school, but bullying and discrimination against LGBTQI professionals or individuals, frankly, is not something that is confined to the school. And so I was wondering maybe if a few of you can speak to how that bullying or discrimination may persist throughout one's life and really what forms it may take. Is it just simply overt or is it some other form? So I don't know, maybe Katie, if you wanted to take that question.
Thanks, Usman. excuse me, and welcome everyone. I am thrilled to be here today. Super important day. And just a moment to pause and reflect on why inclusion is so important. And I'm going to ground my comments on bullying with that concept of inclusion, because we saw when everybody after this video or after this webinar goes and watches Chase and Aisling's film, which I commend 110%, you'll see the importance of feeling like you're not part of the community in which you're actually existing. You know, Billy's story is of really not being able to present himself or his truth for his entire life as he created a very rich and long life. That happens day one, that sense of, do I belong or do I not belong? Whenever anybody walks into a workplace, when they join a new group, when they switch departments, that moment of introduction and whether you're going to introduce yourself happens over and over and over again. And hopefully we've seen a pretty strong reduction in overt homophobic and transphobic comments. I suspect there's still lots of thoughtless transphobic comments that get made and said every single day. It's the subtle stuff in the workplace that I think personally does constitute bullying. So who you want on a team, who you want to staff with something. If you keep going back to the well of the people who are like you, who don't make you feel uncomfortable, who you think there's some magical unspoken language that right. makes it easier to work with them, you may think that you're just getting the job done, but I would argue that you are actually bullying by exclusion. And every time you aren't thoughtful about how you build your team or who's included, you are taking away opportunities for people. And so 3, 4, 5 years down the road, when it's time for them to be assessed for whatever their next level of accomplishment is within your firm, or when they start to move to grow their career, excluding people is going to cause them real economic harm. And it also means that they've spent years not feeling part of the team. And, you know, I'm sure TD and Gowling's really focuses a lot on the team. The team's got to be reflective of everybody who's in the entire department or the entire firm. And it's, you know, it's not going to be all the same type of people. So you need to make sure that your team is really feels welcome. The importance of allies. Interestingly, I'm going to flip over to another speaker. We have a number of, we call them employee resource groups within our inclusion and diversity framework. And the two leaders or allies for the out group are both straight white men over 50. And I think it's, you know, they've signed up for the same reason David said, because it shouldn't be both the burden for feeling excluded plus the burden of speaking up and saying this is wrong can't fall on the same people over and over again. So allies, when you see somebody who's sitting in the corner not talking about their weekend or not part of the next project, it's time for you to reach out and bring them in.
Warren.
Hi, thank you for your comments. Welcome, everybody. Thank you for joining us. I think that just to focus for a moment on the bullying that people face as kids, I think it's important to recognize that that is, you know, some of the experiences that, you know, I can only speak from my personal position, my personal experience. And I realize that, you know, I am a, you know, gay, cisgendered white man, and I have certain elements of privilege that have protected me from a kind of bullying that some of my colleagues who have different identities and from might have faced and certainly do face. But when you're a kid and somebody hurls a gay, you know, anti-homophobic epithet at you or a transphobic epithet at you, even if they don't know the truth about who you are, that hits you really, really deeply. It creates a sort of like feeling of shame that you can't really vocalize. And I think that the world has come a long way. We certainly have come to, you know, at least in Toronto and in Canada, we've had great strides towards creating workplaces and public spaces where those kinds of things aren't tolerated quite the same way they were. But every now and again, you will come across, even in the workplace, a more casual kind of homophobia, homophobic jokes, or, you know, people who you encounter who seem to think that being gay or being trans is something that you do as opposed to something that you are, and sort of betray that sort of sensibility behind it. And, you know, you may be confronted with again, just, you know, an inability to know exactly how to address that, or, you know, a feeling of shame again that, you know, is brought up and brought back from your subconscious. And it's definitely like a lasting legacy that we really need to collectively root out and recognize that people are who they are and they have the identities that they have, and create space for that to be something that they get to be proud about and get to be open about without having to endure these feelings and having that psychological trauma of childhood raised in the workplace. Our world has come really far, and yet you know, even today, if you're walking, you know, through the gay village or on Yonge Street, which is one of the main drags of Toronto, people will drive by and heckle you. They will hurl homophobic epithets from the windows of cars. So no matter how far you come, there's always that risk. There's always that feeling. And then sometimes, you know, even as a society, all the advances we've made prove not to be universal. So I think there's still significant work that we all can do to root out bullying.
Oh, that's great. And so let me maybe shift, if I may, the conversation to our co-directors, Chase, Ashling. Your new film, No Ordinary Man, looks at the life of a jazz musician, Billy Tipton, who performed in an era where really there was no transgender representation whatsoever. And so what I was wondering is if you can perhaps just give the audience, particularly those who have not had a chance yet to take a look at the film, what the movie is about, how it came to be. And if you can perhaps maybe speak to in particular the bullying that Billy endured during his life and also it appears long after his death.
Sure. Hi, thanks for having us. I'm Ashling, one of the co-directors. So the film, as expressed, is about Billy Tipton, who was a jazz musician who came up in the 40s and 50s and 60s and grew up in Oklahoma and kind of toured as a gigging musician and married and settled down and adopted three kids in Spokane, Washington. And after his death in 1989, it was outed to the media that he was a transgender man. And then the media kind of took hold of his story and really turned it into something that it wasn't. And our interest in making this film really, you know, sprung from finding out who Billy was. It started as a seed of an idea at Parabola Films, a production company in Montreal. And then myself, Amos Mack, a co-writer, and Chase, we you know, took all of the things that we wanted to express and our ideas and the different topics that we wanted to explore, that Billy's story became a very, very wonderful and vibrant vehicle to kind of to open up and to tell his biographical story from a trans perspective. So that's kind of, you know, in the kind of general sort of idea around what we were trying to do. And also in terms of how we were able to kind of make our very diverse and LGBTQ plus team very, you know, robust and in meaningful positions really came with us having to challenge and push the institutions that were financing the film to another level and to really make them understand why storytelling and why financial resources need to be put into the hands and into and towards the projects that are about people telling stories about themselves.
Right.
Just okay. To add some thoughts, yeah. I will say that in the many years it took to make this film, I don't think we imagined ourselves to be in a legal webinar of 500 plus people. So very open to these new opportunities and thanks for the invitation. You know, the question of bullying is so interesting when you think about Tipton, because as far as we know, Tipton wasn't bullied when he was alive. He was living stealth, he was not recognized as a trans man, and it was in fact not being visible, was allowing him to move in spaces unrecognized as different. And, you know, so often visibility of social change that, you know, being visible is better, but I think it's also really important to recognize that the underbelly of visibility is vulnerability. You know, when people know how to recognize difference, they learn how to discriminate against it. And so it's really the media who is responsible for bullying Tipton and his family in the wake of his death. And, you know, the media and the law are signals for how to treat people. And it's really interesting to reckon with Tipton's legacy and its relationship to bullying as one that's happening by and through a more contemporary vantage point, that it wasn't necessarily true in his lived reality or his lived experience.
Great. So let's maybe turn to the question of maybe organizations. How can they address discrimination or the bullying that has been described at an organization level? We have a lot of people, it looks like over 500, 600 people who are now on this webinar. A lot of them are looking for some recommendations, and maybe there is no science to this. And I know, David, you have strong views on that, but maybe Al, if I can turn to you, What are some things that organizations can do perhaps to address discrimination or bullying in the organization?
That's a great question. And there's not one, obviously, magic bullet to do this. This has to be strategic in this thinking in terms of diversity and inclusion. And it's a bigger conversation. You know, bullying and discrimination is one part of exactly what you're trying to accomplish with diversity and inclusion. It has to be business imperative. It has to be part of your leadership framework, your business strategy. What we say at TD Bank, it's part of our DNA. And actually, we've said it's a non-negotiable business practice. And it is, that's a rule of engagement at TD Bank. And it's embedded in our guiding principles and leadership framework. It's not an HR issue only. And that's where leaders come in, and which is very important. And we have to recognize this, that also it starts from the top. So me seeing Peter on this call and your leaders yourself on this call is very important. We talk about visibility, but it has to start from the top. And what I said in my first question was, but it can't start and stop there, right? So if we think about it, even the word, we're talking about bullying here in the context of LGBTQ2+, it spreads across every diversity and inclusion group. Think about it, right? You're a woman, you know, Black, what's going on right now, very heightened conversation in the Black community, indigenous peoples, visible minorities, you know, persons with disabilities. It is a bigger and broader conversation. But also what I said in terms of leadership matters, but it can't start and stop there, allyship. And a lot of us on the call already talked about allyship, even on this call right now. Employees on this call, watching in, seeing us, panel of panelists having a conversation, Peter, your leaders here. But at the end of the day is when they go back into their workplaces, they want to see that signal from their managers also. Mm-hmm. Think about that, right? They're going to want to see their managers lead by example in the same fashion. And unfortunately, or fortunately, in a way where a lot of times we talk around and don't include allies, especially, you know, cisgender, able-bodied, straight white male, who make up a lot of organization, middle management. And we talk around them and we don't really engage them in a conversation, understanding what we're trying to accomplish with inclusiveness in the workplace or diversity and inclusion, that they need to be part of this. And we also know that, and I'm a prime example, when I was being bullied in the workplace, I was not performing to the best of my abilities. Think about that, right? It was not until I felt a sense of belonging that I was able to spread my wings and see that, have hope that I could reach my full potential. So a couple of things I would say, leadership matters, lead by example. Education and training is important. I saw one of your leadership principles about raising awareness. That is definitely important. You have to send that strong signal to the organization. This is important, okay? But then now you move from that diversity of thought now to inclusion, put it in practice. So now you're gonna say, okay, how do we now mobilize Gowlings now to say, this is part of our DNA. Policies, procedures, you drill down. Then you also now, I'm so heartened to see that you have now have your open house. Now you get employees now to be part of this mix to say now, and I would say, use your employees, not as an employer resource group only, but as a business resource group. Your employees will give you information on how you should help shape your culture, get them involved. We call something at the TD Bank as dual accountability and responsibility. You have to keep your organization accountable of here's what you need to do as an organization to create an inclusive environment where everyone can achieve their full potential. But then on the flip side, employees now need to be part of that to work together. Someone talk about majority, and I will pass it off quickly in the speaker. I'm very passionate about this subject, obviously. It's my day job. If you think about it, inclusion starts, if allyship starts, okay. If every group I just mentioned, women, okay, 50-odd% of the population, okay,
right,
consider a diverse group, LGBTQ+, 10% of the population or so, person with disabilities, indigenous peoples, visible minority. If we all came together as each other's allies, not only for anti-Black racism, anti-Asian racism, LGBTQ2+, et cetera. If we all came together as each other's ally, we make up the majority in most cases. We have full control in that. with our voice of unity? And then how do we now use that power together to impact change, systemic change? So that is where we have a conversation of the three elements, the head, the top, right? Then the middle, and don't laugh, and then the bottom of the organization coming together and working together to create change. So that would be my advice and what we use at the TD Bank as a framework structure.
Yeah, a lot of the comments that you made really resonate with me. I mean, Chase said, look, I never expected to have our film in a legal forum. Like, I never expected to be leading a panel on LGBT myself. And so I do think, as you're saying, Al, it is important for us as leaders to stand and be counted. And I am gay. I'm South Asian. I'm Muslim. I'm from Chibougamau, Quebec. I'm diverse on many fronts. And if I can even affect one individual at our firm who could see a reflection of themselves, I feel like that's a life worth living. So I don't know, what are your thoughts, Rebecca, on this? What say you?
Well, I think it's wonderful to bring together, popular culture and law. And when I was doing my PhD, I talked to Chase about this previously, studied the work of Austin Surratt, who's a political scientist, who talked about legality as lived. The law has an existence in our lives and through those micro processes. So we can have policies on a corporate level. We can have policies firm-wide. We can have laws that protect people. We can have human rights laws. We can have charter rights in Canada. But if we, in the day-to-day experience of going to work, is that you get bullied, and not necessarily by a person who's in a position of power over you, but if you hear negative remarks, then the legality, the law as lived, is something very different. So it's really important, I think, for us as lawyers, those of us watching who are lawyers and, work in the formal processes of law, to look at the critical legal studies approach of how popular culture, how the way the media, for example, attacked Billy Tipton is relevant to the existence of law and the existence of legal protections. So on an organizational level, there is a saying that culture eats policy for breakfast. And I didn't make it up, but I think it's a really good saying in terms of, we can have great policies, and large organizations in a contemporary space, like our firm, which is a multinational law firm, like big business banks, corporations, often have pretty good policies. That doesn't mean they can't be improved. We can always improve upon them. But at the same time, we can have those policies that can exist over there. It also needs to be changed on a day-to-day level of microprocesses. You may have heard the term microaggressions, microprocesses, that moment to moment. So when we are working in terms of organizational change, we have to be working on the ways that culture, which is that total, that accumulation of those microprocesses, impacts the way people experience their lives. So in terms of organizationally, we need to look at policy. And that doesn't mean policies are perfect, but as lawyers, we're kind of good at that, right? We're better at looking at policy, and we always want to amend the policy. And we should do that. There's a time for that, there's space for that. But in terms of holding two ideas in your head at the same time, the idea of moving culture and doing small things mindfully and working with representation and being mindful of what we take in, what we talk about, what we discuss, what we explore, I think that can be very beneficial. So there is incredible relevance of a documentary film to the work that we do as lawyers. I also wanted to say, picking up on something Al said, the notion that of intersectionality, right? So today is not about me because I'm an ally. Right? I am a heterosexual woman. I'm a single mom and I'm dealing with COVID, but I'm a heterosexual woman. And the issue today is, as an ally, how can you step back and support what's really going on for the people who are foregrounded? And it's important to note intersectionality as well. And that's where I wanted to pick up on what Al said, which is the idea that together, those of us who are identified in a variety of different ways as diverse, whether as women or racialized or as members of the LGBTQ+ community, these are really significant things to be looking at, but intersectionality is significant. So for example, one thing to think about today, Indigenous law is a really important part of our practice, two-spirited people. The fact that we are in Canada always, as settler peoples, walking on the lands of Indigenous people and how those things are connected together. So when we're talking about, gender identity and sexual orientation, it's also relevant to talk about indigeneity. So to look at those things together. So in terms of organizational, take homes, I would give you three. One, culture and policy have to both be worked on. 2, allyship is important. And 3, we have to look intersectionality about how things connect with one another.
Okay, and just in the interest of time, maybe Katie and David, maybe Katie first, just briefly, if you had thoughts on that particular question, what can organizations do to address bullying or discrimination for LGBTQI individuals? Sorry, go ahead.
So Al and Rebecca had principles, a tactic. So the first is very simple. If you've got a panel, if you've got a leadership opportunity that your organization has, if you look at it and it does not look diverse and it does not reflect the full range of people who are in your organization, you change it up. Nothing, literally nothing. And if there's people from CPPIB who are on, nothing makes me the top of my head blow off more than panels that are monochromatic. People see leaders constantly, and if the only leaders they see are white cis men, they will never see another leader in their imagination. So if you're on a panel, if you have the opportunity, change it up. Second, and this, Aisling, you reminded me, I didn't even say this yesterday. So I'm head of compliance. It's my job to make people follow rules. People are designed to avoid rules. So that's where I think is how do I get people to do the right thing? So we've just done a compliance video, and we did it in a cartoon instead of a policy about how to avoid illegal insider trading. And I made the lead couple that opens and closes it, they're a biracial lesbian couple. And then all sorts of stuff happens all the way around the world. And I paused for about 2 minutes. I'm like, should I do this? Everybody's going to be like, oh, that's Katie again. And I was like, no, they should do that. Why should it be a straight couple? Why should it be a white couple? But of course, and I made the person who did the wrong thing, the white person who's like going and like doing all this stuff. But I never even thought about the fact it's because my organization gave me the opportunity to make the video that I made a video that looked like my life.
Right.
So, David? Mix it up, folks, mix it up.
David, go ahead.
Look, it's impossible for me to tell someone in this session what they should do specifically, because every organization's circumstances and culture is different. But I think there are two preconditions for organizations to address bullying and discrimination. One is they need to be curious, and the other is they need to be committed to change. And using love and empathy as guides to power that curiosity and commitment can be useful. For me, being curious means understanding what the actual problem is, what is going on in your organization. And to do that, you've got to understand both the impact on individuals. So what is the lived experience of people in the workplace, but also the combined effects which show up in the data. And this has a lot to do with belonging for me and who gets to decide who belongs. You know, the behavior of individuals is what creates inclusion or exclusion, and the structures and processes in an organization create inclusion or exclusion. And being committed to change means that addressing bullying and discrimination and creating inclusion is seen as a skill. And like all skills, it needs to be learnt and it needs to be practiced. You know, addressing bullying in an organization by getting people to wear a rainbow lanyard, for example, or a unicorn badge is kind of like walking around with a tennis racket and saying you're now a tennis player. You know, you have to go through the education, the skill, and you have to then put into practice that skill in order to make change.
So Aisling, Chase, would Billy's experience as a transgender man be different today? How could we, or would we have, or could we support him in present day scenario? What are your thoughts on that?
Yeah, you know, it's such an interesting question, because when Billy was gigging, he was alive at a time where the categories that we all inhabit were literally being made. So we can look to research in the medical industrial complex and doctors who are saying, what is this? Who is that? What do we call this, right? It's really a moment of reckoning. So one of the things that our film does is, you know, claims Tipton as a part of a trans historical legacy while recognizing time and time again that we might be wrong. We don't actually know how Tipton identified. And in some ways it doesn't matter, because what our film is doing is trying to ask a different set of questions, which is, what does it mean to look back and claim someone in this way for contemporary trans culture makers. And, you know, I think to imagine a world where we don't actually know, and we can think about the way in which that translates to all of our lives in these rooms. You know, it's gonna sound like a bumper sticker, but, you know, the thing that we learned from Tipton is to believe people when they tell you who they are. Tipton was a father, was a husband, was a musician, and lived an incredibly vibrant and successful life. And we can believe him and trust him on his own terms.
Ashling, do you have anything else to add to that, or?
Well, just to kind of continue on with this conversation about inclusion and how division is so often used as a tactic itself to marginalize people further. And we see that in government, we see that in lots of different ways, and especially what's happening right now in the US in particular, and policy and law, specifically against transgender youth. And so as culture makers or as people who work in the legal system or in a corporate setting to be able to stand up for the rights of people that are marginalized, and also to be able to sort of siphon those resources or siphon opportunity and access to these types of experiences, so that there is a more holistic way that we understand different people's experiences. And in terms of Billy, like Chase said, like, you know, he lived a very successful life. The people who worked with him had nothing but respect for him. His children loved him. He had lots of, you know, wives and people who also have, think only fondly of their experience with him. And so, you know, there's such a celebration to be had in that. And so we wanted to uphold that, but obviously to layer in how much the complexity of his life and through the different decades that he came up in. But, you know, I think it's a combination of exclusion, actively fighting against divisive tactics, and also us, you know, a celebration of the diversity of experience.
So in one of the panel pre-calls that we had, Chase, you had said something, I believe it was you, who said that in order to have meaningful change, one has to have hard and uncomfortable conversations. And I wanted to know if you can just maybe elaborate on that, because I think that was an important point that many people in the audience would want to hear.
Sure, absolutely. So, you know, Ashling and I'll use we statements. We really identify as collaborative beasts, you know, and really building a story, not only together, but with the communities most impacted by our storytelling strategies. And so that means being really explicit about the ways in which power operates, not only in our interpersonal relationships, but in our film. So we can think about it structurally when Sarah Spring, our producer, stopped the machine of production to say, we need to fundraise more money because we need to pay trans creatives robustly to be making a project like this and participating in a project like this. Or whether it's we're in the editing room and thinking critically about how patriarchy and white supremacy are reasons why Tipton was able to live and move out of these social and political spaces in a way that I've summarized in a previous response on this panel. Get explicit, get specific, and try to work with that thoughtfully from the start.
Good. So what I wanted to do, if I can now, is just maybe welcome in some of the members of our Open House Canada group. And so they can go ahead and turn on their screens. And these are professionals or employees from all of our various different offices, whether it's Ottawa, Calgary, Toronto, and elsewhere, Montreal. So welcome. And so one individual that I wanted to perhaps start off with is to give a little bit of a sense of her experience. If you don't mind, Catherine, if I can pick on you for a little bit. So Catherine is a law clerk, and she's been with our firm for a few years. And so Catherine, I was wondering if you can maybe give a sense as to the then and now, how you've seen the field of law sort of evolve on these issues over time. So perhaps if I could turn it over to you.
Sure. I've been in the profession for 43 years, at the firm for about 24. And I can relate a couple of experiences that I've had in the past and how things have changed for me. I worked at a firm in the early 80s, and I was having a discussion with a colleague about the Pride Parade, which was really just a day then. And they were saying, you know, there's no need for a Pride Parade. You don't need to march down, you know, Church Street or Yonge Street, you know, proclaiming that you're gay. You know, it's just not required. And to be very honest, at the time, I agreed. You know, things were just so different. And I didn't really feel the need to do so until I went to my first Pride in 1986. And, you know, it was such a great feeling of hugs and everybody saying happy Pride and a feeling and sense of belonging and being okay, like validated me somehow. And then, you know, coming out of the Metropolitan Community Church service out of Maple Leaf Gardens and protesters being there, but somehow that was easier to handle because the majority of the people that day had accepted me for who I was. And now, you know, years later working at a firm that, you know, I don't have that conversation with somebody saying they don't understand a need for a Pride Parade. And in fact, the firm participating and, you know, marching alongside you at those, you know, events. I also worked at another firm where I, when I wasn't really out in the early 80s and, you know, developed a whole new language of speaking about what I did on the weekend by terms of they, and, you know, not allowing myself to be my true authentic self by saying I was dating lesbians at the time, women. And, you know, it was a whole new language that I then unlearned later at subsequent law firms where it was okay to talk about these things. So I've seen a lot of change, a lot of acceptance, not to say there's not, you know, as Warren and other people have all demonstrated with, there's still some definite homophobia out there and people who don't understand, but I have seen a huge change and a good one, a positive one, and just can hope for it to continue.
No, that's terrific. And if I didn't mention it, Catherine is a law clerk in our Toronto office. So Tyler, you're just really starting off your career. And if I can maybe ask you, and so I should say Tyler McRobbie is an associate in our Calgary office. What advice would you give to allies around you who may be too uncomfortable to ask certain questions or maybe unaware of certain issues?
First of all, thank you for having me. I think that's a great question. And, you know, I think it's really important. I think a lot of really sort of insightful things have been said in terms of the role that allies can and should play. And I've been hearing a lot of a sort of a theme developing, if I can call it that, with respect to the idea that allies should be and are certainly welcome to be playing a proactive role in this entire process and everything we've been talking about today. I think we heard that from David and Katie, especially the idea that allies should be playing a proactive role. You know, I think that opens some opportunities for, you know, potential, I don't want to call it pitfalls, but there are ways in which allies, you know, have a role to play, but might not necessarily know what exactly that looks like. And I think that might also be the case as well within the LGBTQ community. I, for example, identify as gay, but the LGBTQ community obviously is an umbrella of multiple forms of sexual diversity and gender-based diversity, not all of which I necessarily associate with. So there's multiple sort of forms, I think, of allyship, both within the LGBTQ2+ community, as well as sort of without the LGBTQ2+ community. I think when it comes to the allies who are participating in this call and those who work at firms like Gowling's and its clients and things like that, you know, all you have to know at the end of the day, I think, is that if you're coming into this process with, you know, the true intentions and the spirit of wanting to improve and make yourself better, as well as the sort of world around you, it's hard to sort of do wrong. I think if the intention is there, you know, that's the starting point, and that's the most important, you know, thing, because that is what's appreciated from people like me who seek out those allies and who need those allies, because there's power in numbers and there's power in the sort of authority that comes from people sort of signing up for this concept. If I had any sort of specific advice, you know, I think it's kind of on a maybe person by person basis, but I think it's just a question of reaching out and just saying, you know, just having that conversation and coming from a place of empathy. You know, I don't see, and I'm extremely blessed at Gowling's. I would say it's been an incredibly fruitful experience for me in my time here in terms of what that allyship has looked like. I you know, it's just the friends that you make, it's the associations that and the sort of commonalities that you find with people who might not be LGBTQ, probably aren't in fact, but who can still empathize with you in a lot of the same ways. I think it just starts with that conversation and that intent to actually do something and to make your life better, your lived experience better, and to sort of take that step towards expanding that to the LGBTQ community if you maybe haven't already. I think allyship is incredibly important just on the basis that, you know, our numbers are limited. I think Al pointed out earlier, if you put us all together when it comes to Indigenous, women, all of the other sort of diverse subsets, you know, there's power in numbers, and I think that needs to be explored further, but it all starts with that first conversation and an open mind towards the empathy that you need to come into that conversation with.
Okay. Oh, look, you know, just on that, I did some sums and worked out if you put all of the LGBT plus people in the world together, we would constitute about the fourth largest country. So there's some power for you.
Yeah. And Usman, if I can jump in quickly on the role of allyship, which is really important. And I think the uncomfortable conversation with allyship is, and we've seen it being talked about, is you can't just say you're an ally and just sit back and just announce the word, I'm an ally. There's work to be done if you want to be an ally.
Right.
You're going to move from this performative to intentional allyship. And that's where the uncomfortable conversation comes in, asking an ally, so what have you done to help? And that's important. And that's what we've been asking ourselves now, to move that conversation. And we have this analogy, and there's work for allies to do, and there's work for us to do in working together with allies and creating an inclusive environment for them to work. It starts with the head. And that's what we're doing here. We're understanding, you know, the principles we've talked about, diversity, inclusion, the knowledge base. Then we move to the heart, the empathy, to empathize, the lived experience. That's work for the allies now, to interact, do the work in the process with us being your guide also. And then use your hands and feet and act, because that's the only way we're going to move and talk about systemic and not just, you know, one and done. If we want, really want to stem up systemic discrimination, that is the work we need to do together. And people always say, you know what, it's a big initiative and how can we all work together? And I would say it's every individual. Don't look only at your leaders. Of course, leadership matters, but you are a leader in your own right. If you think about it, in most cases, an ally is a person with some element of privilege. Use that privilege you have, use that access you have, use that platform you have in your circle, and that's how you make change. And if everyone does that, incrementally, that's how we make impactful change going forward.
Okay, terrific. So I know Louis Renee, you have a question. Maybe if you can just introduce yourself and go ahead and ask your question.
Yeah, so I'm Louis from the Montreal office. I'm a recovery services clerk. And well, it's for you as men, my question, as well as any lawyer online. I would like to know if being LGBT nowadays still closes doors in the law field.
So Warren, do you want to go first, or would you like me to go first?
Oh, but you can go, you can answer the question.
Okay. I see you opening your mouth, so go ahead if you want to, or I can go. Whatever you prefer.
I can't be anything other than what I am and who I am. So I have found that being out and being my genuine and true self has allowed me to become a part of every legal environment that I have wanted to be a part of. I think, you know, this kind of goes back to some of the comments that were made earlier by Rebecca about not only rules and policies, but culture and the importance of a culture in a workplace, you know, the importance not only of finding opportunities that are not expressly shut down or made unavailable to you because of your identity, but also a place where you feel that you can shine and you can perform and you can succeed and you don't have this nagging, you know, thought in the back of your head about, you know, am I being my true self? What happens here if I show my true self? And you're not constantly confronted with contradictory sort of messages, comments that, you know, make you feel uncomfortable or ashamed, or, you know, watching comments that are made about other people or other groups that, you know, kind of set off the same sort of sensors and feelings in you. So while I can't comment on every single, you know, legal environment that there is, I am happy to say that the legal environments that I find myself in are terrific. And I have many friends that have found themselves in legal environments that are terrific for them as well. So I think there are a lot of places we can succeed. And I think that by raising the excellence of those environments through our participation, we can show other environments that aren't quite there yet the importance of changing the way that they are.
Yeah, I mean, to speak from my own perspective, I unfortunately have seen the fact that somebody has come out closed doors in rare exceptions where it is overt. And I say that because let's not be try to put, a shade glass over our eyes as to what's happening. There are circumstances where individuals will continue to harbor prejudice, and they may not say it overtly, but opportunities will not be given because an individual is from the LGBT community. And unfortunately, that still does occur. And sometimes it occurs not only overtly, it will occur indirectly because a person may not see reflection of themselves in that individual. And so it's sort of, maybe it was what Katie was saying at the beginning, maybe it was you, Katie, who was saying this, is that people are naturally inclined to go to those who they're more familiar with. And sometimes because of that, doors are closed indirectly, not because the person means to do it, but it's this, what we deal with that, what we try to train individuals at this firm, like we have unconscious bias training so that you can identify that. And so for example, if I say to somebody, well, let's go for drinks. Well, what if the individual is Muslim and they don't drink? Then they're not feeling included. They may not want to come because there's drinking involved. The same thing with the LGBT community, it occurs as well. There's also sort of a closure because, or a minimization of opportunities because, again, I think it's maybe what Katie had said, is that sometimes when you cannot bring your true authentic self, it's almost like a cancer that feeds on yourself because you can't be free, you can't be open, you can't be authentic. And that, whether you like it or not, may involve affecting your work quality, that it then leads to less work because you are suffering inside. What we've been trying to do at our firm as well is use LGBTness, sort of what Al was saying, also as an opportunity. And so creating those networks and allowing all of you from Open House and elsewhere to be able to interact with professionals outside and to be able to showcase yourselves through webinars like this will lead to opportunities. So we're trying to allow that, that aspect of ours to also help grow our books, et cetera, et cetera. So we're trying to also use it for in a positive way and try to minimize those circumstances where opportunities are closed to individuals. So anyway, I hope that offers some answer. Maybe we can go to Donald Keddie, who, if you don't mind introducing yourself and asking your question.
Hi, I'm Donald. I work with the HR team in our Ottawa office. My question has to do with microaggressions and how can individuals appropriately address them in the workplace?
So does anybody want to take that question? Yep, Katie, go ahead.
Thanks. Thanks for your question, Donald, because it gave me an opportunity to talk about what I forgot, which is everybody's own individual responsibility to speak up for themselves. You know, when we talked about what allies can do, what I forgot to say is if you are feeling uncomfortable or if you're feeling excluded, you need to raise your hand and call people on it and find the courage to do it, because 9 times out of 10 it's somebody being thoughtless as opposed to being overtly nasty. So the microaggressions happen all the time. Like they happen. I've been out for 25 years. I've been married for 20 years. I have kids. I have pictures of my family in my office. I work with lawyers and others who are finance people who are super smart, who see my office, who will literally 2 years ago ask me about my husband and why my kids, you know, why my kids look different. So you just have to call it in the moment, and don't like find the courage not to put up with any BS. So if somebody's making you feel bad, tell them.
And I would just jump in and said, you know what, if you create an inclusive environment to give people understand that they can actually speak up without any repercussion, that's important as a baseline, I would say. What we do, we're Canadians. We don't like confrontation and we skirt around. Let's be honest here. So what we've done at TD, we've tried to be very tactical. So one of our senior executive team, Nori Campbell, actually, you should know him, Nori. She said she had this technique she used. It was ouch. She heard something in the quintessential Canadian way and she will say ouch. And that opened a conversation of what do you mean by that? You know, it's like coaching 101. Some people, you will know when someone is malicious, their intent really malicious, then you can really go hard at that person in terms of that's not right. But then there's these microaggressions. And what I do, and I hear it all the time as a Black gay man, especially on the Black side, trust me, I get it all the time. As a Black man, I always ask and come from my intent of understanding. Tell me more, what do you mean by that when you say that? And let's have that conversation. Let's unearth the root cause here. And that's how I go about and do training actually. I use the ouch technique a lot and people look at me and say, what's that? And I'm okay, let's have a conversation. Or I'll genuinely come from a good place and said, maybe that person doesn't know or doesn't understand that that's a microaggression. It's so unconscious. I will ask, what do you mean by that? And then we'll have a conversation.
Okay. Yep. I just add something to what Elle said there. I love the question, Donald, because to me it goes to the heart of this issue around what we're talking about earlier and what Chase was talking about around difficult conversations. And the insidious thing about microaggressions is often the person doing them is not aware that they're doing them, but often the recipient isn't even aware that they are the subject of them and that they're being affected by them. You know, it's referred to as a death by a thousand cuts sometimes. These small little signals. And I certainly know that's been the case for me. You know, it's kind of like the frog in the water, isn't it? The temperature's been turned up slowly, frog isn't aware. And I kind of, you know, after a while you realize, I just don't feel like I belong in this workplace, but I can't put my finger on a single incident. And I think everyone loves the rainbows and unicorns bit, that's fun. But when you have a colleague or a student in tears because they've experienced bullying or homophobia or biphobia or transphobia, then it's no longer so much fun. And I really kind of endorse what Al's saying about, I don't want to comment on Canadian politeness, but you know, Canada isn't the only polite country in the world. And certainly in the UK, I know that our workplace often feels nice. You know, we have nice conversations with each other. We avoid the difficult topics. And this can just mean that those topics are then not addressed and therefore the work that needs to be done doesn't get done. And sadly, it can create a sense of complacency amongst our leadership where they start thinking, oh, well, I haven't heard anyone complain, so everything must be okay. which of course no good leader should ever do. And Peter, of course, you wouldn't do that, would you?
So he's silent on that, but I'm going to tell you he's probably saying no. He better be saying no. So I'm going to take a few questions from the audience. So I'm going to take a few questions from the audience, if you don't mind, just in the interest of time. So one question is just picking up on something that Katie had said. So thinking about Katie's comment about bullying by exclusion, even inadvertent exclusion, is it ever appropriate to ask about someone's sexual identity to avoid excluding someone and having that person assume that it was because of their identity? So does anybody want to respond to that?
Sorry, can you repeat it, Usman?
So I guess what they're basically asking is it ever appropriate to ask somebody about their sexual identity to avoid excluding that individual, or maybe picking up on your comment about how somebody may be quiet in a room and you're not sure why, maybe is it appropriate in any circumstance to ask as to what the reason is and maybe identify that issue particularly?
So I've been a people manager for a long time, and I think you would focus on having a conversation first and outside the group. Really interested to hear what Chase and other people may have to say on it.
Yeah, in our case, again, it's the culture. You have to create this culture that it's okay to ask that question, first of all. At TD, what we start doing, we start sending those signals which are important. So on everyone's email address, for example, you have an option to put your pronouns on your address, for example. And we have these training to, as best practices, to don't assume anyone's identity, and we ask. So again, it's a journey and a culture. So it's okay for me, and no one at the bank would feel, I would say, they would not, I would say, feel threatened if I asked, how do you identify? It's a norm now in our organization. So that's on our journey. I would say, would you ask me maybe 10 years ago, would I be comfortable as a people manager to say that? Absolutely not. So in that case, I would say we maybe case by case in terms of the culture you have created to date.
Right. And sorry, Chase, did you want to say something to that, or?
Oh, I was just going to say, you know, I think in all of these conversations about support and allyship, we fall into a trap when we think that you can read or see queerness and transness. It produces a lot of assumptions about who's in the room or outside of the room. And so I think kind of as a baseline, maybe to that question, is never assuming in the room means that you're always thinking in multiples and always thinking against the kind of choices you could be making in a workplace that would exclude some people who identify in certain ways. You know, I think that I encounter a lot of questions and conversations in public, and more often than you would probably imagine, people say to me, well, I've never met a trans person before, or you're the first trans person I've ever met. And I love telling people that they're wrong. I like, without question, they are totally wrong. And so like, what does it mean that people think that they live in a world where they've never encountered someone before? And I think that's an interesting place to spend some time if you find yourself there.
Good. So let me push on to the next question. One individual is wondering if the panel can address the less explicit ways that queerphobia pops up in the workplace. For example, maybe typical dress codes make non-adherence to certain gender norms. I'm just trying to follow the question, but maybe if you can just speak to those less explicit ways that queerphobia pops up in the workplace. Like, could it pop up in the context of the way one dresses, et cetera, et cetera? Maybe if people can speak to examples of that. Go ahead, David.
So yeah, I absolutely, I love the question, because I think forcing us to think through the consequences of what we take for granted is part of that journey of curiosity. And as Chase says, not making assumptions. There is so much that we have grown used to leaving at the door of the office when we come into the workplace, that we've kind of, you know, again, like this frog, this warming up frog, we're not even aware of it. And I think being really conscious about that, you know, organizations are starting to look at things like dress codes and say, well, do we need to go down to that level of detail, like an adult to a child saying, you know, women are to wear high heels and dresses that have to be below the knee, and men are to wear ties and this, that, the other. You know, many firms now have a dress code that just says dress appropriately for your day, whatever that looks like. And that feels a lot more adult to me. So I think this question is part of a wider question of us understanding, you know, what drives belonging in organizations. How do I know I belong here? How do I know I'm safe here? And how do I know I'm loved? Yeah. And, you know, if we think about it, the issue of belonging within the LGBT or the queer community, particularly the corporate environment, is kind of this experience of not actually experiencing love. You know, Let me ask you this. Can you say you feel loved by and in your organization, your current one, or in any of your previous workplaces? Have you ever felt that love? And if not, have you ever wondered why? So, you know, there's kind of a chance here for LGBT plus people, because we probably more than any group know what it feels like to be excluded because of who we love and how we love. So let's turn that negative experience on its head and create kind of radical belonging for everyone by infusing our workplaces with love. And if that means tearing up outdated policies that treat us like children, then let's do that.
Yeah, I agree with you in terms of the journey. Diversity and inclusion is a journey. You just start somewhere and you learn. And that's why employees are so important in this mix. And it's a business resource group. They'll tell you, 10 years ago when we started with, you know, it was mainly gay policies and gay issues and experiences. Then we start doing more about lesbians, now bisexual, now queer, non-binary, et cetera. We're going down and deeper as we evolve. So you're right. And you got to constantly bob and weave. We even having a conversation now about, should we use the word guys on calls anymore and folks instead? Right. When I best practices as a leader, when I start a meeting, I announce myself. My name is Al Ramsey, and my pronouns, I believe you said that also, he, him, and his. Those are sending those signals. It's those little things that you do that you have to put in organization. And your employees, you got to always get a pulse on your employees and do those climate survey and focus group. And you will know exactly how employees are feeling, and you have to pivot. You have to evolve. And I would tell you, I'm learning every day. 16 years of doing diversity and inclusion work. And every day, especially the younger generation, they challenge me right now to learn more how to be even a better inclusive leader.
Well, if I could just go to a few last questions. One, I think, is an important one, and it's really more directed to you, David, but I'd open it up to anybody. So one question is, as a bisexual, pansexual person, it is often hard to find support within our own LGBTQ plus community, and it has a lot of jokes attached to it. And so the individual says, I want to be authentic, but I have concerns about my workplace after what I've experienced in the LGBT community itself. Any advice, David, or others?
Well, as someone who's had a similar-ish journey, in the sense that when I came out as bi, I lost what I call a lot of my gay street cred. You know, I'd been identified as a gay man very openly for 10 years, and that had built up a lot of cred for me. And then when I said, actually, I'm bi, there were a group of people within the LGBT community who couldn't get their head around that, who asked very intrusive questions. Are you sure? And I think my first comment would be to you is that it is your personal choice how you show up, how you identify. No one can tell you what to do, and no one can tell you what it means to be you. So that's the first thing. You always have that right. You always keep that right. And it is a personal decision to what degree you're out about what things in your life. Straight people are in the closet about certain things. It's not only LGBT people who can be closeted. Straight people can be closeted about being a carer, about having a parent with Alzheimer's, about being having a mental health issue. So all of us are in the closet about something. And therefore, the idea that we all have to be open about everything about ourselves in the workplace is not right and not fair. But I would just say that if you feel that it's going to serve you well to be more courageous and more open, find some people you trust. Find some allies, find some people you know are going to support you, and use that support and that friendship to help you build the kind of belonging that you want to experience.
Okay, anybody else?
I would just say we just launched our first this year bisexual employee resource group, because we had feedback from our overall Pride network at TD that they don't feel that they belong to what we're doing. And we heard the same thing when we started 16 years ago, lesbian telling us that all this stuff you're doing, Al, is geared towards you, your gay friends. I remember those conversations back then. So we had to dig deeper. And this year we've started a trans committee with a trans man and woman leading that committee. And we have one for bisexual because we know the experiences and the needs are different. That's what you're telling us. And that's, so I agree everything David said in terms of it's individual and, you know, in terms of how you show up in the workplace. And we have to just keep on, that's one word I find in this space is in diversity and inclusion, we continue have to evolve. It's a journey. It is a journey. You got to be resilient. You're going to make mistakes along this journey, but your employees, I would say, they will guide you.
Well, we have some catching up to do. You have. let me put the ask the last question to go to Tyler. Go ahead.
I'll ask the last question, but I also just wanted to maybe follow up on that previous question that was asked of David. My only comment in closing would be that, and this has been a process for me as well, and an ongoing one at that, we're conditioned to think that we should fit within, you know, a certain box or a certain paint by numbers sort of regime to our lives. But I think to answer that person's question about, you know, concerns that they have in their workplace, it's maybe not the most satisfying answer, but something that I've had to learn about myself is that we need to start experiencing or viewing this diversity or these unique traits of ourselves less as a weakness and more as a strength. In fact, it's one of our greatest strengths. And I think that's important to always keep in mind that we're conditioned to think maybe otherwise, but you have to learn that, you know, it's a strength of yours at the end of the day. And that's something that you need to always have in your back pocket because it's what you've got to work with. And thank you, Usman, for offering me that spot as one of the final questions here. The question I think I would like to ask of our distinguished guests, the co-directors, Chase and Aisling. Obviously, I think we've referenced already and touched on it. You are two directors of this movie, and we're acknowledging the fact that you're speaking to a largely corporate audience, and I would imagine, unfortunately, as well, a fairly sort of, I would imagine, affluent and Caucasian audience. And so one of my questions for the two of you would be sort of what your perhaps sort of distinct perspective on these questions, what do you have to sort of, what has that taught you that you might be able to share with a decidedly corporate audience that you have before you today, just for a sort of a new lens to look at for the rest of us?
Oh, thanks for the question. Sorry, I also have a puppy on my lap right now. He did.
I saw that.
Sorry about that. I think one of the things that's always good to remember that from my perspective as a racialized woman, like that I remember the certain privileges, the certain disadvantages I have, but also the certain privileges that I have, and to be able to use my privilege and the access that I've been afforded that perhaps other people from different backgrounds and experiences have not been able to have. And it's my job to open up opportunities for other people. It's my job to also get out of the way of other people when it's their space to inhabit. And I think that when we talk about allyship and leadership and all of that, a lot of the reasons these discussions are happening is because the leadership does not reflect the world, doesn't reflect the diversity of the world. And at some point, it's not just about giving trainingships and, you know, certain lower level jobs or lower level opportunities or part-time opportunities. It's really going that top level needs to change and the risks need to be taken. So I would say that just having, you know, one's own look into where am I helping and where am I also hindering from just not from inhabiting a place that should be given to or should be given an opportunity to somebody who's from a marginalized group or somebody who's from an experience that isn't represented in this sort of corporate hierarchy or in some kind of way.
Collaboration is the future. So happy for Ash's words to be the last.
Well, one last word that I want to say before just handing it over to Peter is that if you enjoyed the film, which you will, if you can go ahead and rate it on iTunes, Rotten Tomatoes, and IMDb, I believe our co-directors would greatly appreciate that. So I just wanted to give a shout out to each of you on that. So let me turn it over to Peter for the final words.
Thanks, Boosman. And as I've been listening to the discussion, I was thinking, what could I say? And then thankfully, because, you know, as lawyers, we always like to borrow other people's words. I have the benefit of a question that our audience isn't able to see, but this is from one of our audience who summed it up to me, and it's this: wow, thank you to all the panelists. Mind-blowing and mind-opening, so refreshing. Couldn't say it any better than that. So to whoever penned those words, thank you very much to our panel for an extraordinary 90 minutes, and thank you to our hundreds and hundreds of attendees. I know that we weren't able to get to all of the questions. We had a number of questions. I figure that with the help of Usman and his knowledge of blockchain technology, there must be some way that we can get the unanswered questions answered and out to everyone who submitted them and took the trouble to submit them. I mean, if blockchain is worth anything, it should be able to have a ledger of questions, as I understand how this technology works, should have a ledger of these questions to which we will try to provide answers. So thank you everyone for attending our first ever Open House Day of Pink webinar. And I can guarantee you it will not be our last. So I bid you all a good afternoon, a good late morning if you are in BC, and to Mr. Pearson, he's probably on his way to the pub after this. So have a nice evening. Cheers all. And I guess Al's camera has exploded after absorbing all of those different shades of pink. So hopefully he's okay. Thanks everybody, goodbye. Okay.
Thanks a lot, everyone.
Thanks for the invitation.
Bye.
Bye. Bye.